Sairam, and good morning, everybody. It's a privilege to be back at home. I have been assigned the job of going through the mitral valve anatomy, and I understand the responsibility. For the next 1.5 days, you'll be deliberating on this particular structure, and I've tried to do my best to refresh you with the anatomy stuff. So I'll be talking basics of the mitral valve anatomy and how do we classify the mitral valve diseases. So before we start up, I just want to take you through some absolute facts. Anatomic knowledge has been driven by surgeons. The coordinated opening and closing of the heart valves, it occurs approximately 3 billion times in an average human life and is required for unidirectional blood flow. The concept of the mitral valve as found by an anterior and posterior leaflet, it has changed. At present, mitral valve is understood to be found by 6 distinct leaflets with 1 anterior, 2 commissural and 3 posterior scallops. Just to take you for the name Mitre, I take you down the memory lane. So it was the Belgian anatomist and physician André Vesalius who coined this term because it looked like a bishop's hat, so mitral valve. And I'll take you over next 2 minutes of the development timeline. So it all starts in 5th week of life, and by 15th week the mitral valve is formed. So we see the source of the mitral valve is mostly the superior, inferior and lateral cardiac cushions seen in the common AV canal. This is the picture to show that this is the ventricular cavity, the atrial cavity, and this is the endocardial cushions, and these are the different indentation of that, and it starts by 5th to 7th week, and by 14th to 15th week the mitral valve is formed. So if you look at the formed mitral valve, what you see, the anterior or the anterior leaflet component is from the superior and inferior part of the AV canal cushions, and the mural or the posterior leaflet, it is from the right and left, I mean the left lateral component of the AV canal cushions. This particular picture tells you about the fibrous skeleton of the heart, how the heart valves are arranged, and this is the fibrous skeleton, the white things. And this is giving a orientation, I'm sure most of you have seen through this, how all the four valves are spatially arranged. It's very important for us to know. And before you go closer to the mitral valve, it's important to know the anatomical structure surrounding the mitral valve. So you have got, this is the surgeon's view, this is the head end, this is the tail, I mean the leg end of the patient, we are opened through the left atrium, and this is the AML, this is the PML. So what are the things that is important for us is knowing about the location of central fibrous body, the AV node, and we have the coronary sinus on this part and the left circumflex artery on this part, mural leaflet and the anterior leaflet. Mitral valve is not mitral valve per se. It is ideally called a mitral valve complex. And when you divide it into different components, what you see is the vulvar component of the leaflets and commissures, it has annulus, it has caudi tendine, papillary muscles, which is called subvulvular apparatus. You got the left atrial myocardium, left ventricular myocardium, left atrial and left ventricular endocardium, and of course there is a outer mitral curtain or outer mitral continuity. So the whole of this thing is the mitral valve complex. And if you look at the annulus, let's go one by one to different part. The zone of junction which serves as the attachment of the muscular fibers of the atrium, ventricle, and attachment of the mitral valve, and it extends between the right and left fibrous trigone. What is important to know that between the two trigones, the mitral valve is in continuity with the aortic wall, and there is no fibrous mitral annulus in this region, contrary to the belief that it is all fibrous all around. It's a dynamic structure, it has a sphincter-like function, effectively decreasing the valve area about a quarter during systole. This is seconded to contraction and relaxation of the vasoconstrictor muscles. And if there is dilatation of the mitral valve annulus, it usually occurs posteriorly. Now, when you look at the shape of the mitral valve, a lot has been done after the 3D echo and other imaging technique to see how it looks. It looks like a saddle, and N phase mitral annulus resembles a kidney bean, but in 3D it is in a non-planar saddle in shape.
It is not circular, neither it is oval. That is very important to know. And when you see the mitral valve in different part, these are all different drawings taken of the annulus in different phase of the heart contraction, and the what red thing you see is something at the mean of that. So you have got an anterior aortic peak which corresponds to the midpoint of the anterior mitral leaflet, and you have got a midpoint of the posterior annulus, so they are the higher points, the highest points of the mitral valve, and the lowest point is at the commissures. So this is the posterior commissure and this is the anterior commissure, so they are the lowest point of the mitral valve. So the mitral annulus, it's a fibromuscular ring to which the anterior and posterior leaflets are attached. The normal mitral valve has a 3D saddle shape with the lowest point at both the commissures. This is one of the commissures, the other side is the other commissure. Now, as I already told, the important structures for us to keep in mind when we are dealing with mitral valve is the AV node with the coronary sinus and the left coronary artery, circumflex artery, sorry. Now, we'll go to the leaflets in detail. So the leaflets has been, this is a picture splitting up the leaflets and telling each component of that. So you start up from A, the component between A to B is the anterolateral commissure. From B to C is the anterior leaflet or anterior valve. C to D is again the posterior medial commissure. D to E is the posterior medial scallops or the first scallop of the posterior leaflet. E to F is the middle scallop, and F to A again is the anterolateral scallop. Then you have got papillary muscles and the cord is attached in the commissure. So the leaflet, mitral leaflet, is a continuous veil attached to the circumference of the mitral annulus. The free edge hangs into the left ventricle and it is split by indentations. There are two well-defined and constant indentations. They are the anterolateral commissure and the posteromedial commissure. So at present, the mitral valve is understood to be formed by six different scallops or different leaflets or scallops with one anterior, two commissural and three posteriors. The leaflets is covered by endocardium. There is a distinct ridge on the atrial side. You can see this red dotted line, that is a distinct ridge. So this defines the line of closure and it separates the leaflet into two zones. The rough zone, which is distal to the ridge, and this represents the surface of coaptation, and the other part is the clear zone, which is proximal to the ridge. So when you see the anterior mitral leaflet, it is a semicircular triangular. It is attached to 3/8 of the circumference of the mitral annulus. It has got common attachment to the cardiac skeleton, especially the left coronary cusp of the aortic valve and half of the non-coronary cusp. It's important for us to know, we may think that the mitral valve leaflets are symmetrical. They are not symmetrical. They're pretty asymmetrical. This is an endoventricular view where you can see that part of the lot of chordae in the middle part of the AML is crossing the midline. So it is not symmetrical as normally believed. Now the posterior mitral leaflet, it's a quadrangular in shape. It is attached to the rest 5/8 of the circumference of the mitral annulus. It has got two indentations forming three scallops, which is anterolateral, middle and posteromedial. And the cleft chordae, they insert into these indentations. So when you see the posterior leaflet more closely, what we see that it has three zones, unlike anterior leaflet which has two zones, rough and smooth zone. This has three zones. So the third zone is the basal zone, and that is between, it is in the middle scallop especially, and this is where the basal chordae are attached. Now going to the subvalvular apparatus, which has the papillary muscle and caudate tendine. So papillary muscles are two groups, anterolateral and posteromedial. Each group supplies chordae to the respective half of the leaflet. So mind you, anterior leaflet also has chordae from anterolateral papillary muscle, and anterior leaflet also has chordae from posterolateral papillary muscle. So this is how it is. The anterolateral papillary muscle, it gives chordae to both A1 and A2 segment and part of the A3 segment and also P1 and P2 segment. And posteromedial similarly also gives rise to A3 and P3 and part of A2 and P2. Now coming to caudate tendine, they are the fiber strings that originates from the tiny nipples of the apical person of the two papillary muscles. Majority they have got branching pattern, either soon or after their origin from the papillary muscles, or just before the insertion to the leaflets. So chordates have been named and renamed. So just to take you through that, the chordate tendini, it can be commissural chordates, chordates of the anterior leaflet, chordates of the posterior leaflet, it is the major division. And when you go individually into that, they are the main chordae, the paramedial chordae, paracommissural chordae, the vasal chordae, the rough zone chordae, and the cleft chordae. So the old terminology was first order, second order, and third order. Now, what is followed by Ricci et al. Revised in 2005, where they again call it commissural, posterior marginal, anterior marginal, then posterior intermediate chordae, and anterior straught chordae, and vasal posterior chordae. So the commissural chordae, there are two in number, one for each commissure with similar names. They arise in the main stem, which branches radially to insert to the free margin of the commissural region. Their attachment defines the extent of the commissural areas. This is a picture, again, endoventricular view of the anterior mitral leaflet of the main straught chordae. There are two in number, one from each papillary muscle. You can see that one from the anterolateral papillary muscle and one from posterolateral papillary muscle. They are inserted at 4 to 5 o'clock or 7 to 8 o'clock anterolaterally. Now, what is important is, typically these chordae, they split into three soon after their origin, before the insertions. And if you look at this particular picture, this is the main straught chordae, these are the commissural chordae. So what is in between is paramedial chordae and paracommissural chordae. Similarly, the chordae of the PML, it is also from both the papillary muscles. What is unique to the PML, that it arises as a single strand from the left ventricular free wall of the small trabecular canne. The rough zone chordae tendini is similar to AML, but shorter and thinner. And the cleft chordae, they insert into the indentation of the PML. So if you see at each zone, what is important, like I told you, six scallops. So you have got roughly around six in the anterior leaflet side and eight in the posterior leaflet side. So that amounts to roughly around 28 main chordae, and there can be variation of basal chordae. Now it's important to know about this particular dynamic structure, the blood supply of it. All of us are aware of that, especially mitral leaflets and chordae are avascular. What is vascular is the papillary muscle, and it is supplied, anterolaterally supplied by the left anterior descending, and in addition by the diagonal or OM branches from the circumflex. The posterior lateral is supplied by the branches of either the left circumflex or the right coronary artery. So after this basic description of each component of the mitral valve apparatus, I want you to go through how do we, when you see a mitral valve as a surgeon, how do we look into that, how do we assess it, and how to go about the pathological classification. Carpentier was the one who actually classified into A1, A2, A3, P1, P2, P3. And Duran, he divided the chordae by the insertion of the chordae from the papillary muscles into A1 and A2 and P1, posteromedial and P2. And there is a proposed new classification where, again, it is based upon the combination of Carpentier and Duran, where they want to divide it as per the insertion of the chordae into both medial and lateral aspect. So it is A1, A2L, A2M, A3, and P1, P2L, P2M, P3, and of course the commissural scallops. So there have been different ways of classifying based upon anatomic study, based upon surgical studies, and based upon echo classification. I'll not go into the details, but just to tell you about the functional ways what Carpentier defined, the functional classification of mitral valve diseases, they're type 1, where normally you have the normal motion of the leaflets, annulus is normal. Type 2, there is excessive motion, either prolapse. And type 3, there is restrictive motion, which is A and B. So the retraction causes 3A and apical displacement that causes 3B. So just to take through the last three slides, for a surgeon, it is important to know the spatial arrangement of all the cardiac valves, knowing where the mitral valve is. We have to know the conduction tissue location in relation to the mitral valve and the circumflex artery and coronary sinus. And it's important to know the segmental anatomy as per modified Carpenter thing. And it is important to systematically go for segmental analysis from supravalvular region, to annulus, to leaflet camiseus, to tendinous cords and papillary muscle. And after this anatomic definition, it is important to classify them as per Carpentier as type 1, type 2, type 3A or type 3B. Thank you.